Oh, This time we'll go to the Lord in prayer. Does anybody have any outspoken requests this morning? Continue to remember Scooter also. Amen. Amen.
We're really in need of the Lord's hand right now.
Yes, we do. Anyone else? How about the uplifted hand? Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Precious Heavenly Father, we come before you, Lord, and we ask you, dear God, to hear each and every one of these requests that are brought before you. Lord, we pray, dear God, that you would deliver those that are sick. Dear God, that you would comfort those that have lost loved ones. We know it's been tough on this country, dear God. And we pray, dear God, that you would just straighten things out. That you would come and take your children home. We pray, Lord, that you just use each and every one of us to draw each and every one that's lost this in our lives, Lord, that you would just help us to draw them to you before it's too late. We pray, dear God, that you would help those, dear God, that are suffering from cancer, Lord, that you would heal it. Lord, and those surgeries, dear God, that need to be done, Lord, that you would just guide the hand of the surgeon. We pray, dear God, that you would touch Brother Jr., touch Sister Carol, and Sister Teresa. Lord, give them strength through this time, dear God, that they're going through. We pray this all in Jesus Christ's name. Amen.
I was thinking and praying yesterday for Junior and Teresa and them, and then I was talking with Junior a little later on, and of course, you know, I can't imagine the bills and probably that are going to come from this. We pray and ultimately for God's healing. Of course, that's the main thing, the money thing, to take care of himself along the way, but I just feel like we as a church ought to do something to help their family. Junior said he was going to be able to take American Leave Act or whatever to be at home and help take care of Teresa when she comes home, but he won't be getting paid during that time. And so I would love to see us maybe take up a special offering maybe next week, and I don't know, I'd just love to see us maybe raise $5,000 for Junior and Teresa to help them during this time. And I'd just like you to consider that, pray about it. My wife and I are going to lead by giving $1,000, and so you do as God leads you to do. And God will help meet that need. You know, we're a family of God, and as a family of God, we need to stand together with a family, amen? And so I just ask you to do what God lays on your heart. Don't worry about what anybody else does, but you do what God lays on your heart, and God will help them meet their needs, amen? One thing we can do is maybe lighten the burden a little bit, amen? And so we'll take up a special offering next Sunday morning for the Lamb family. So remember them in prayers and continue to lift them up this week. Song leaders will come and take out your hymn books, 589.
Done.
Yes.
If you're out of check.
Write it to the church. The church will give it that way.
Yeah.
ancestors come to receive our Sunday morning tithes and offerings, may we be faithful to give to the Lord, and may God bless us as we obediently give as God has directed us. Brother Dan, would you bless the offering?
Dear Lord, please bless this gift from the giver and use it for the building of the kingdom and saving souls in Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen.
Church and to the Dobbses that we were able to honor, and we received several phone calls from them this week, by the way. Pastor Dobbs called me at least 3 times, and Mrs. Dobbs called me yesterday, and they were just overwhelmed by the grace and mercy and the love that was bestowed upon them. We also received a card yesterday. It says, Donnie and Tracy and all of Rosebud brothers and sisters, we wish there were words to express blessings you all gave to us. What a wonderful service. I wish I could call each of you by name with the thanks, but we pray God will bless you all fourfold for your gifts for us. We would like to be there next Sunday, but God has placed us in another vineyard. God bless each of you. And then she writes a P.S. We will try not to be jealous of next year's recipients. Praise the Lord. So we love the Dobbses. Continue to pray for them, that God bless them. Amen. Our song leaders are going to come now and sing and lead us in yet another song.
Stand, turn, hymns, page 682.
Stand up for Jesus, ye soldiers of the cross. It ties royal banner, it must not suffer long. Victory unto victory, his army shall he lead.
Thank you for singing for us this morning. It's on leaders and choir. Let's turn our Bibles to Matthew chapter 24. We'll go back to the same chapter we were in last week, looking at a few different verses in a little different context. Matthew chapter 24, we're going to begin reading in verse number 32. Matthew chapter 24, verse 32. If you can and will stand with us for a reading of God's Word. Matthew 24, verse 32. Now learn a parable of the fig tree. When its branch is yet tender and putteth forth leaves, ye know that summer is nigh. So likewise ye, when ye shall see all these things, know that it is near, even at the doors. Verily I say unto you, this generation shall not pass till all these things be fulfilled. Heaven and earth shall pass away, but my words shall not pass away. But of that day and hour knoweth no man, no, not the angels of heaven, but my Father only. As it were in the days of Noah, so shall also the coming of the Son of Man be. For as in the days that were before the flood, they were eating and drinking and marrying and giving in marriage until the day that Noah entered the ark, and knew not until the flood came and took them all away, so shall the coming of the Son of Man be. Then shall two be in the field, the one shall be taken and the other left. Two women shall be grinding at the meal, the one shall be taken and the other left. Watch therefore, for you know not what hour your Lord doeth come. But know this, that if the good man of the house had known in what watch the thief would come, he would have watched and not suffered his house to be broken up. Be ye therefore ready, for in such an hour as ye think not, the Son of Man cometh. Let us pray together. Father, we love you, Lord, and thank you, Lord, for this precious privilege we have to come together in your house and to worship you. Lord, we long to see you, and you encourage us to pray, even so come, Lord Jesus. And Lord, we know that we are in the late hours, and we know that our Lord doeth return soon. Father, we pray, Lord, your hand would be upon us, and Lord, would you speak through us today as we preach your word? Would your spirit, Lord, proceed forth and accomplish its purpose in our ears, and may our ears affect our heart, and may our heart walk diligently with our Lord. Father, we pray, would you bless now the preaching of your word, and we'll praise you and give you glory for all that you do. In Jesus' name, amen. You may be seated. I want you to think on the thought, the one shall be taken, the other left. One shall be taken and the other left. You know, we live in a day of great trials and tribulations. The days in which we face are days unlike anything the Bible declares has ever been upon the face of the earth, or ultimately will ever be upon the face of the earth. But yet people seem to take life for granted, don't we? I was just thinking about Mike Edwards, who passed away this week. His complications of the virus or complications of the medicines that doctors give. I don't know which one he died from. It's hard to know anymore, isn't it? Can't trust the medical professionals, and it's a sad day we live in. But I was thinking, I saw Mike at Chick-fil-A the last time I saw him, and it's not been but just a couple months ago, maybe. And everything was wonderful. Everything was good. You know, we don't know what life holds. The Bible describes life as a vapor that appeareth for a little time and vanisheth away. I was at the house yesterday morning, and my phone rung, and I hadn't changed it on my phone. And my dad, of course, has my mom's phone now because it's a smartphone. His old one was a flip phone. And so when I look at my phone, it says Shirley Price. And I thought, my, wouldn't it be good to talk to her again? The truth of the matter is, we don't know when the last time we're going to get to speak to someone we love or care about. In a moment, everything in life can change. We take so much for granted. And yet, you know, it's one thing to take for granted opportunities that come along the way that we may take advantage of or we may miss. But how tragic is it when we fail to take advantage of the opportunity of eternal life? How many times have we heard of someone passing and we think, man, I had an opportunity to speak to them and I didn't about the Lord. Or I had meant to get to them and talk to them about the Lord, and I didn't. Missed opportunities. Because we don't ever know when one's going to be taken. And by the way, many times it's not the one you thought would go. Or the one that seems to be sickly. Sometimes life just takes those in the prime of life. Those who it seems had all of life before them. And the truth of the matter is, there's appointed in a man once to die. And the Bible declares, after this, the judgment. Jesus declared in this sermon on the Mount of Olives that everyday activities are going to be going on. Men are going to be working in the fields. Ladies are going to be working in the grinding mills and so forth. And those were the normal everyday activities of those days. And we know what it's like sometimes when you get that phone call and someone you love, someone you know, someone you hold precious has breathed their last breath. And sometimes it's expected, but sometimes it just comes from total surprise. But we know this, that short of the Lord coming and taking us home, every one of us have an appointment with death. If you live long enough, you're going to die. We just don't know when that appointment is. We don't know what we might be walking around with right now, amen? I mean, every so often you hear of someone who, you know, they just seem to be a picture of health, and all of a sudden they get a diagnosis of cancer in a few days or a week or 2 weeks have passed and they're dead. One taken, the other left. Now this text that we look at this morning that we've read speaks specifically toward the end times and the coming of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ and the rapture of the church. But you know, it doesn't matter whether you go by way of the rapture or you breathe your last breath and die. At that moment, one thing matters. One thing. Not where you live, not who your mom and daddy was. Not whether grandma went to church or not. The only thing that matters is that you bow your head, confess your sin, and ask Jesus Christ to come into your heart and save your soul. Because you know what? As good a people as we are, and I use that in jest, because Jesus said there's none good, no, not one. As good as we think we are sometimes, hey, remember, we are not good in the eyes of God, and in the concept that we're all sinners. And because we're all sinners, we deserve judgment. And God describes that judgment, and Jesus describes that judgment as a place of eternal damnation called hell. And some people say, well, I don't believe in hell. Well, I don't believe that matters, whether we believe it or not. The Bible declares it and states it. And so to be absent from the body as a believer is to be present with the Lord. But according to Luke 16, when the rich man died, he opened up his eyes in hell. So, one shall be taken, the other left. You know, my dad is one of 11 children. But there's only two left. And if God tarries at some point, there'll only be one of the two left. And then eventually that generation passes away, right? That's the way of the world. The Bible even declares it. The book of the writings of Solomon says that one generation passes away and another generation cometh. And so is the course of life. So the responsibility that we have is, as he declared here in the scripture, to be ready, for we don't know when the Lord's coming. We don't know. Now in this scripture we see that there are some precursors, some things that would alert us that something is on the horizon, but we really don't know exactly when the Lord is coming. And we'll look quickly this morning. It first begins to talk about some of the signs of the times, and I would refer to that kind of as a thunderstorm building on the horizon. You know, long before the lightning strikes and the thunder claps, You can look to the north or to the west and you see the cloud, right? It's building. How many times have you been out working, maybe cutting the grass or whatever you do outside, and you see that thing building and you begin to work with haste, trying to finish what you're doing before that storm gets here? Can I tell you, my friend, that's where we're at today. The storm clouds are rising. And whatever we're going to get done for God, we better get on it with all we've got. Hey, if we're going to get saved, we better get saved because we're not promised tomorrow. The storm is rising. The lightning is coming. He talks about that in this text. Matter of fact, if you were to go back to verse 27, I believe it is. He says, "For as the lightning cometh out of the east and shineth even into the west, so shall also the coming of the Son of Man be." Now let me tell you, the lightning seldom ever is seen or ever exposes itself from a clear sky. Amen? You're only going to have lightning when the storm is building. And the storm at that point is upon you. Maybe in the distance you see the lightning starting to light up the sky and you know it's coming. And Jesus said the coming of the Son of Man is going to be like that. It's going to come as that lightning. And it's going to brighten up the firmament. Because why? God is coming. And listen, those things that are done for God better be done before He comes. The Catholic Church has got it all wrong. When they believe that a man can die in his sin and somebody else can pray him into heaven. There is nowhere in Scripture that aligns with that kind of concept. The reality is that if you personally are not born again because you decided to trust Jesus as your Savior and to confess your sin as an individual, if you've not received Christ, my friend, and you leave your last breath leaves your body, you are without hope. That's why the Bible declares that salvation is of today. It's important that we understand that we're not promised tomorrow. I've often heard people say, "Well, I'm a preacher, I'm going to get saved one day." How do you know you're going to have that one day? No man is promised another day. The Bible describes life as a vapor that appears for a little time and vanishes away. And boy, the older we get, the more we realize that it really is just a vanishing thing, isn't it? Yeah. I mean, most of us can look back on life and think, man, where we're at, we used to think that was old. Amen. Now we don't think it's so old anymore. The only thing that's changed is we have, amen. The truth of the matter is, though, if we live long enough, we're going to die. The Bible describes this great gathering of storm clouds that is a picture of what is to come, coming of that great power of God. And yes, I believe in the imminent return of Jesus Christ. I believe He can return at any moment, and I believe He'll call His church home. I believe that. But if He don't and we die today, what's the difference? Encourage you today to realize whether the Lord returns today or whether God chooses our number today. Have you ever missed an appointment? I have. And I set an appointment sometimes to go meet with a customer to look at a job and boom, I forget about it. I know you don't do things like that, but I do sometimes. Wow. But I promise you this, whether you forget about it or whether you don't know about it or whether you never heard of it, when your appointment with death comes, you'll be it. God said His appointment in the man once to die. And after this, the judgment. We're going to stand before God one day. And we're going to give an account of everything done in this body, whether good or bad, the Bible describes it. We better be ready. The Bible says one shall be taken and the other left. This morning, I want you to consider your life. Are you ready? I ask people that sometimes. They say, "Well, I'm a good person." Some have told me, "Well, I've joined the church. I've been baptized." That's not the implication of the question. See, because being a good person is all relative. I mean, we can all find somebody to compare ourselves to and be a good person. I mean, you could probably compare yourself to the car salesman and you're not that big of a liar. Amen. You can compare yourself to to somebody to make you look good. But see, the reality is we're not comparing ourselves to somebody. We're comparing ourselves to Jesus Christ. And he is sinless, perfect, without sin. I didn't mean that, Carlson. I just realized Carlson's horse. You still selling horse? No, okay, he's not doing it. He's really not a big bad of a guy anyway.
I sell car parts.
You sell car parts, okay, amen. He doesn't say part of it at a time. But the reality is, you get my point here. Listen, everybody can find somebody to compare yourself to and make yourself look really good. But the reality is when we compare ourselves to Jesus, if you will, when we look into the Bible, it says the perfect law of liberty. We don't look good. Because we're sinful men. Every one of us. Even the Apostle Paul talked about sometimes how the things that he would not, that he didn't want to do, sometimes that's the very things he finds himself doing. And the things that he desires to be, he finds himself not being that sometimes. And my friend, if that is the Apostle Paul, I know it's me and I know it's you. The only good news is I've been washed in the blood of Jesus Christ. Amen. My sins have been washed away, into the sea of forgetfulness, never to be remembered anymore. And when I stand before the God of heaven, the devil can make all kinds of accusations against me. And probably every one of them are true. But then my Jesus can stand up for my defense, because that's what the Bible said he is. He said, I don't see any of that. All I see is the blood of Jesus that washed away his sins. I'm glad today that I'm not going to go to heaven because I thought I was a good person, because I tried to do good things. Reality is nobody goes to heaven that way. If that were the case, then Jesus didn't need to die. The Bible says one shall be taken and the other left. You know, I can't help but think sometimes I hear of people dying maybe of a heart attack or just eat up with cancer, and they finally have made it to the doctor, and the doctor's like, there's nothing we can do. If you were to rewind their life a little bit, I think a lot of times there were some opportunities they had to know, you know, something ain't right. But we are often, as men, and I think as mankind, not just physically as men, but as mankind, we're often trying to deceive ourselves. I know one guy that I can think of right now that he wouldn't dare go to the doctor because he was afraid the doctor was going to tell him he had cancer. You know, the truth of the matter is, he already knew he had cancer. He knew something was awfully bad inside of him with all of his pains and all of the aches and all the things that he's going through, but he just didn't want to go because he was afraid that what he was thinking was true. You know, the reality is, we're not going to live forever. I don't know what God's plan is. I believe God could come this week, today. A few years ago, one of the families in our church, we dismissed church, everybody's leaving, and they go up to the highway, and they turn to go get on the highway, and before they even reached the highway, they're still on the entrance ramp. A truck comes all the way from the other side, crosses the two lanes of traffic, and hits them head on the entrance ramp. Unfortunately, nobody got killed or anything like that. But do we realize just how quick life can change? From the point where we could be among the living, where now they're covering our body up with a sheet. Life is a vapor. And this morning I want us to consider the opportunities that we have. Maybe as you consider the parable that Jesus gave of the 10 virgins. And the Bible describes 5 of them as being ready. They had oil in their lamps. The 5 of them, their lamps were dry. They weren't ready when the Lord called. No one asked you this morning, are you ready to meet the Lord? I'm not asking you, are you hoping you're ready? You know, do you know that you're ready? Because I'm telling you, death is so final, it's not worth taking a chance. You say, well, I hope I am. I went through a motion, did this when I was young. Let me tell you, if you don't know 100% sure that your sins are washed away, that you have a home in heaven, let me encourage you. I want to help you today. Because the Bible says we can have a know-so salvation. The Bible says you can know it. Matter of fact, he says, whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. That's not a hope so or maybe so, but a shall be. He also says, let the redeemed of the Lord say so. Amen. How can you say you're redeemed if you don't know it? And I want to encourage you today that you have an opportunity today to receive the Lord, to get things straight in your life with God. See, it says, then shall two be in the field, the one shall be taken and the other left. You know, I think one of the saddest things that I've had to deal with over and over as a pastor, sometimes getting called to minister to a family in their time of loss and to try to encourage them in a funeral service. And if there's times when I don't know the family member that passed away, and sometimes it's an extended family member or whatever that you get called in on, I always look to the family. I'm like, were they saved? And when the family looks at you and says, we hope so. Well, I don't know. Church, we have opportunity today to know so. We have an opportunity today to minister to our family, to reach out to those that may not be saved. Because you don't know you're going to have next week. Matter of fact, you don't know you'll be here and you don't know they'll be here. Because two are going to be in the field. The one taken, the other left. If you're one of those two, are you going to be taken or are you going to be left? That's the example that Jesus gives us this morning. And if you don't know for sure, let me tell you, don't let the devil discourage you. Don't let the devil keep you back. I'm telling you, my friend, there is nothing like knowing for sure that you're saved. Amen. By the way, I'm not saved because I'm a good person. And I'm not saved because I don't sin, because we all sin. That's why he gave us 1 John 1:9. If we confess our sins, he's faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. But that's to the believer. Once you get saved, you still got to battle the flesh. But I'm glad to know that even though I battle and even though I struggle sometimes, I'm glad to know that my Redeemer lives. Amen. And I'm on my way to heaven. See, one's going to be taken and the other left. And I praise God, I'm going to be one taken. You know, they have all these depictions many times of what happens in the rapture and, you know, the planes and the cars on the highway. And, you know, I'm glad I don't have to worry about being left behind. I don't have to worry about being back there in that plane without a pilot. I don't have to worry about a car coming at me and don't have no driver. Amen. Because my car's going to be out there without a driver. Amen. Praise the Lord. Because I know that I've been born again. I'm on my way to heaven. Don't let this opportunity pass you by to receive the Lord, because life is a vapor. Opportunities are vapors, but they pass, never to return again. Scripture says, believe on the Lord Jesus Christ and thou shalt be saved. What will you do? See, I believe if you're not saved today, you only do one of two things. Either humble yourself and come before God and ask Jesus Christ to save you, forgive you, and cleanse you from your sins. Or you harden your heart. Can I be honest with you? There's no middle ground. The Pharaoh hardened his heart over and over until ultimately God destroyed him. I pray that you won't harden your heart. I pray that we'll reach out to our families, our loved ones, our co-workers, our friends, our neighbors, and give them opportunity to receive Christ before it's eternally too late. I thank God that He is our strength. I thank God that today is a day of salvation. Behold, now is the accepted time the Scripture refers to. One shall be taken, the other left. If you're here today and you don't know Christ as your Savior, if you don't know 100% sure that you are saved, I want to ask you in a few moments, we'll have invitation. I want you to come. Let me show you from the Bible how you can know it for sure. Not based on this preacher's word, because I'm going to tell you, if you take man's word, you're going to be in trouble. But you can trust God's word. Jesus says, come unto me, all you that labor and heavy laden. Take my yoke upon you and learn of me. My yoke is easy and my burden is light. Today I pray that God has spoken to your heart, and that God is reaching into your heart today if you're not saved. And as a believer, God, work in our hearts to reach those that are not. Maybe this morning God wants to do something in your life. Would you stand with me as we pray this morning? As we prepare our invitation this morning, I want to pray for you. Our heads are bowed and our eyes are closed. I just want to pray for you. Would anyone this morning say, preacher, God's speaking to me. I don't know for sure I'm saved, but I want to make sure. I want to know for sure. Would you just lift a hand? I want to pray for you. I'm not embarrassed you come to you. I just want to pray for you. Anybody this morning, preacher, pray for me. I'm not sure. I'm not 100% sure I'm saved. Maybe this morning as a believer, you say, preacher, pray for me. I got loved ones. I got family members. And I don't know if they're saved or not. And pray that I don't let opportunities pass me by. How about it this morning? Would you lift that hand? Yes, hands all over the building. Father, we thank you, Lord, for speaking to our hearts. Lord, I pray this morning, Lord, that you would save that which is lost. I pray you bring conviction upon us of sin and of righteousness and of judgment. I pray you would, Lord, save that which is lost. I pray, Lord, you would challenge our hearts today. Lord, the day is nigh. The storm clouds are rising. The lightning is flashing and the Lord is coming. Behold, now is the opportunity. Behold, today is the day of salvation. I pray, Lord, would you do your work in our hearts? Lord, would you save that one now? We pray in Jesus' name. Invitational hymn is Just As I Am, number 275. You know the words. Would you sing it as we sing together? Would you come? If you don't know for sure you're saved, let us help you. How about it today? Don't put it off. Would you come as we begin to sing, Just As I Am? How about it today? Would you come? Would you come? Would you come today? God is speaking. If there's a doubt in your heart, in your mind, let us help you. Of your spirit. I pray, Lord, for that conviction upon any that may be here today and still unsaved. And I pray for the church to be under conviction of those that are lost around us, God. For, Lord, your long suffering toward us, we're not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. Father, I pray, Lord, would you bless your word, and may it be not only just enter our ears, but God, would it find a resting place in our soul. God, we thank you and we love you and we praise you in Jesus' name. Amen. What we have, Christy?
Miss Bethany. Miss Bethany came and accepted Jesus as her Savior this morning.
Amen. Would you come out here, Bethany? Mama can come with you. Come on up here. All right. Praise the Lord.
She's nervous.
That's okay. Look, let me get down here where you're at. You still hurt. That's okay. Hey, you know for sure you're saved. How do you get saved? Did you mean it in your heart? Amen. And the Bible says, whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. And you know, Jesus even said, don't keep the little children from me.
That's right.
Amen.
That's right.
Don't keep them back.
That's right.
But bring them to me. For such, he says, is the kingdom of God.
That's right. Because she said to me clearly, I need to be saved.
Amen.
I need to go down there.
Praise the Lord. Can I have a hug?
Good.
Amen. Glory. Hey, in a few minutes, Bethany, everybody's going to come love on you, okay? Just because we get excited every time somebody gets saved. So I'm going to ask, hey,
you know,
Christy.
Well, and you know what, too? The Bible says that the angels of heaven are rejoicing because you got saved.
That's right.
Right.
Amen. Praise the Lord. So, Christy, why don't you stand on one side and Mama Christy can stand on the other side. And let me encourage you when we dismiss in prayer to come by and give your love and your, you know, just wonderful, wonderful, wonderful news of somebody trusting Christ as their Savior. By the way, think about this. When you get saved as a little child, think of all the things that God keeps you from. Amen.
Amen.
Praise the Lord. May God bless. May God bless Bethany and Christy and our wonderful decision this morning. We're going to be dismissing a word of prayer. I appreciate your faithfulness. Do consider, as I said earlier, for the Lamb family offering next week. Keep that in your mind. And be back tonight for evening service. I encourage you to come back Wednesday night. We're having a wonderful time of Bible study and prayer meeting. And may God bless you and as you join us for that. We're going to be dismissing a word of prayer. Brother Josh, would you dismiss us in prayer?
Put back your heads. Well, thank you for bringing us here today, Lord. And thank you for sending your spirit down and saving Bethany, God. And thank you for everything you do for us, and be with us as we go about to the next appointed time. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.